Good afternoon, everyone. We're going to get started. My name's Courtney Brown. I'm a first-year MBA student at MIT Sloan, and it's my pleasure to introduce the next competitive advantage. This will be predicting MBA season ticket member behavior by Matt Wolf, the Vice President of Team Marketing and Business Operations at the MBA. And without further ado, I'll hand it over to him.
Thanks, Courtney. I appreciate it. And thank you all for coming to chat with me today about predicting MBA season ticket member behavior. You know, before I get into the content here, just a brief overview of the team that I'm a part of at the MBA, which is our Team Marketing and Business Operations Group. Some of you may be familiar with some of the work we do, but for those that aren't, we are basically an internal consulting group for our MBA teams on the business side. So our role is to work with our teams and just make them better, make their lives easier, and encourage them to share information with each other so that, you know, we can take advantage of all the great learnings that are happening in 30 unique demand situations, 30 unique individual markets, et cetera. So we have about 35 folks in our office in Manhattan, and we're set up sort of like an MBA team would be set up. So we have experts in ticket sales and sponsorship all the way through premium and arena operations that are focused with team folks in those functional areas. I help lead a team called the Strategy and Analytics team. We've got a couple of my fellow team members in the back. We basically cut across all these areas of business. So wherever we can use data and analytics to help make decisions on behalf of our teams and alongside our teams, that's what we're here to do. And as part of that, you know, we're very big believers of this notion of data-driven decision-making, right? It's sort of the underlying theme of this entire conference. It's not a radical new notion, but we do believe strongly that the more information we can collect on our season ticket members, our best customers in particular, not only in the aggregate, but on the individual level, we can use that information to help visualize our business or analyze different fan segments, identify new fans, and for the purposes of the conversation today, really engage with and monetize the fans that we already have, particularly our best fans and our biggest spend fans, which are our full season ticket members. So it's interesting to think about in the aggregate how we can view our business, but of course we're also trying to drill down into individual member behaviors, right? So we're big subscribers of this notion. Again, the 360-degree view of the fan. I've heard it mentioned throughout the conference today and yesterday and even in years past. The more information that we have on demographics, behaviors, and psychographics, the better we are equipped to help predict what people are going to do, and specifically if people are going to renew their season tickets year over year. And by collecting several years of information on our customers in partnership with our 30 MBA teams, we've been able to build some pretty powerful tools, predictive analytic tools that help us understand our business. One of which we have actually discussed at this conference before is this MBA retention model. It's become actually one of the most useful tools for our teams. Guy in the back of the room who will probably hate being mentioned, but his name is Mike James. He's sort of the brainchild of this model. And it has been an amazing tool for us. You know, we've basically been able to determine the relationship between various factors associated with season ticket members, and we use that information to build an output that is an account-by-account renewal prediction model. So for any individual account, based on who they are and what they're doing, we can tell a team which accounts are extremely likely to renew, that are probably in really good shape, which are the ones that probably are lost causes, and probably most importantly, which are those extremely valuable fence sitters, the people in the middle where our ability to provide them with a great experience, great customer service, and other certain touch points can be really a difference between a subpar renewal campaign financially and ones like the ones we've been experiencing in the last couple of years that have helped drive us to record season ticket member levels. So this has been a very strong tool for us. But at the same time, we also realize that the retention notion isn't just a year-over-year decision, right? Our teams don't only want to know how this year correlates to what's going to happen next year. They really want to know what is the long-term situation of their business, what's the long-term strength of each of our teams. And to that end, we've started doing more with this notion of survivor modeling, right? So for each individual member in any given year, we know that one of the strongest factors that correlates with their likelihood to renew is tenure. So the longer you've been with us, the more likely you're to come back for incremental season. And using this information in conjunction with the other factors that we talked about in the retention model enable us to build sort of this survivor curve, right? So we know that given where we are today with our season ticket members, we can determine how many of those members will be with us 3, 5, 10, 20 years from now. And you see that most of the decay comes within the first couple of years because the lower tenure members are sort of the most likely to drop off earlier in that life cycle. So we use this to help understand the steady state situation of our business, but not only do we have this information on average, we can also dig into, you know, individual accounts and say, okay, that's the average decay rate, but how do those things change based on certain attributes of the account? So you have things like, what kind of ticket do they have? Do they have club seats or lower bowl seats? Are they a business account? Do they live close to the arena, et cetera? And by measuring the impact of these variables on those decay rates, we find that things like those on the left lead to faster than average decay, right? These are things that are more commonly associated with quicker churn rates, whereas the ones on the right are more commonly associated with more stable customer team relationships. So some really powerful insights for our teams where they can look and clue into these variables and help understand, you know, what's our risk profile? Where are we gonna be at? And these two tools, retention modeling and survivor modeling, have been sort of the core predictive analytics tools of what we've been able to accomplish in conjunction with our teams over the last several seasons. But going back to this notion of the 360-degree view of the fan, one area where I want to spend the bulk of the remainder of our time talking about is one of these data streams, one variable that we talk a lot about, but I think is actually often underappreciated, and that's this notion of survey response data. And actually, even before coming here today, I probably thought this was more underappreciated than it is, but throughout the last day and a half, I've seen some great sessions of folks diving into how we can make great use of our survey data. What we're really proud of that we've been spending some time at here in Teambo is it's one thing to have survey data and look at what people tell us about their experiences as customers of our teams, and it's another to tie those individual account responses to actual behaviors and be able to say, this is what people say, but this is the behavior it actually translates to, and then to draw powerful insights off of that. And thanks to the work of, again, a lot of great people in our strategy and analytics group in Teambo, that's what we're really able to do now, and come up with some really interesting insights, specifically off of our annual season ticket holder survey, which we call our fan loyalty tracker, or FLIGHT. So the next couple things you're gonna see are observations and insights we've been able to draw from this matching of survey response data and behavioral data. I'm gonna give you an example to start out, right? One of the first things we asked in our survey in our effort to try to predict if people are gonna renew their season tickets is, it's not rocket science. We're basically just asking them, are you gonna renew your season tickets, right? So this is a good place to start, probably as good as any, and we give them 5 choices, right? So they can say they definitely will renew, maybe, and then at the bottom, they definitely won't, right? So the question before we had this data was, okay, we know what people are saying on this 5-point scale. How do we interpret it? How do we turn this into predicted renewal rates? So, you know, we had an assumption, and you might assume that if you're assigning weights to each of these things, this is a pretty good guess, right? If someone says they're definitely gonna renew, 100%. If they definitely won't, you know, let's put it in the bank, 0. And maybe, that sounds like the definition of a 50-50. So we tie this to actual behavior, and what we see is quite different, right? It's absolutely different on the top end in the middle, but it's really different on the bottom end of the scale, right? People who are telling us in writing in our survey that they are probably or even definitely not coming back are 50% or more likely to renew, right? So this is pretty interesting in and of itself. We want to dig in more. What exactly is going on here? Why the disconnect? So we went to 2 other very standard survey type questions. One is a general satisfaction question, right? Scale from 1 to 7, how satisfied are you with your season ticket member experience? And then a net promoter score, NPS question. 0 to 10, how likely are you to refer the team to a friend, family member, or colleague, 10 being the highest, right? So we've got a lot of data on these 2 questions, and now we get to play a game that I like to call guess the renewal rate, okay? So we've got four amazing NBA fans. We have the best fans in the world, and we're going to say, we've asked them each these two questions, and we're going to say which two of these fans are the most likely to renew, okay? So everyone, first right off, Carl, right? He's the most likely to renew. Everyone gets this run right. He's extremely satisfied. He's recommending Cavs season tickets to everyone he knows. He loves LeBron. Life is good. Who's the next most likely to renew? Well, we look at this, and we're judging this trade-off between Sam and Larry, right? Because one's a little bit more satisfied. One has a higher NPS. Which one has more value? It's Nick. Nick, who told us that he basically hates us, and he's not recommending us to anyone. In fact, he's probably saying bad things about us. He is statistically the next most likely to renew. Why is this happening? Well, when we dig into the data more broadly, you look at the interaction between the answer to the satisfaction question and observed renewal rates. For people that said 3 to 7, you kind of get the relationship you'd expect, right? More satisfied equals more likely to renew. People that answer a 1 or a 2, they're almost the same as a 7, between a 6 and a 7. And NPS, same relationship, right? So you don't have this direct linear relationship. You've got this U parabolic thing going on here. So what we thought we were measuring here was satisfaction and NPS, and that would tie directly to renewal rate. But I think what we've learned is we're actually measuring something else that's different, but arguably even more important, and that is passion, right? So we have the famous Kristaps kid crying at the NBA draft, and probably at first blush you'd say, oh God, you know, Kristaps kid, he's gone. He's gonna tell his parents to let him spend his allowance on the Yankees or Jets or something. But no, actually this suggests that, you know, the passionate Kristaps kid, given as upset he is and how emotional and passionate he is extremely likely to remain a member of ours going forward because he cares. So we talk about this notion of passion, and this is something that we wanted to dig into more. What else in our survey, even things that are not traditionally viewed as very insightful questions, can we treat as measures of passion? And then what can we learn from that? So we think we found a couple others. One is this one, right? It's not even really a question that most of us think about as something we can learn from. It's just a straight, can we follow up with you, right? Are you willing to have the team contact you to provide feedback? We started asking it just as an honest, straightforward question. You know, we want to learn from our fans, especially if they're unhappy. We want to hear why. And then we learned that people that said, yeah, we can contact you, are significantly more likely to renew than people that don't. Just the fact that they're willing to talk about their experience, they want to be heard, it's telling us that, you know, they value their voice and they value the team. They care enough to spend some time to jump on the phone with us or shoot us an email. Another one, we asked this question. Have you contacted your season ticket representative in the organization in the last 12 months with a specific question or problem, right? Again, originally, we had this hypothesis. People that are complaining, they're upset. We need to worry about this because they're less likely to renew. Then you look at the data, it's the opposite. The people who complain the most, of course, we're not throwing their complaints to the wind. We want to deal with them. We're going to cater to them. We're, of course, going to worry about them. But we also know in the back of our minds that people complaining, they want to be heard. At least they care enough to complain. It's better than that apathetic notion where, you know, they're sort of just checked out and don't even want to talk about it. And then one that I want to dive into a little deeply today is this, right? It's an open-ended text box. So it just says, tell us, free text, what can the organization or team do to make you feel more valued? So there's undoubtedly a lot we can learn from what the people write in this box. But before we get there, there's a lot we can actually learn from just how much people write in the box. Regardless of what they wrote, the more you write, statistically, you're more likely to renew. People, right? We've all taken surveys. How often do you skip the open end if it's optional? Probably all the time. If you didn't, you probably care about the cause, and that is very highly correlated to renewal. So this was a big one for us, but of course, we want to do more than this, right? We want to know more than just the length. We want to get at the meat of those open-end character counts. But this is tricky because, I don't know about you, I don't have that much free time. There's a lot of open-ended responses. People are writing all sorts of different things. Not all of our members' grammar and writing is particularly great. These are some of the better ones that you can make heads or tails of. But more than anything, there's just a lot of text. So in the last several seasons that we've mined our season ticket holder survey, 276,000, now going to close to 300,000 words worth of stuff that people told us. So for context, I'm sure it sounds like a lot. It is. This is the same length as Slaughterhouse-Five, A Tale of Two Cities, and 1984 combined. Okay? So now, here's the question. Put yourself back to your high school days. You get the summer reading list. Right? I took AP Literature. They probably assigned me these three books. They give me the whole summer to read them. What do? 2 days before the start of school, haven't read any of them, obviously. Had better things to do. So I'm panicking. I can't read three books in a day or two. So what did I do? Cheated, obviously. So we have Cliff's Notes to boil this three long novels into a manageable form. We need the Cliff's Notes version of our data, our open-end response data, right? So first line of defense here is often word clouds. We do not like word clouds. We don't find them overly helpful, right? They're just counting words. So if people are saying notionally the same things but using different words, like they're using price instead of cost, you're just gonna get a big price and a big cost, but it doesn't really give you the actual detail there or the sentiment that they're going for. So we need a better tool. So what we have started using more and more is this notion of natural language processing, right? So there's a lot of Python code that is being written by people that are a lot smarter than I am to mine this text and really break down the individual words, recategorize them in areas of topical content, so bucketing long stream text and saying, what are the topics that are coming up and how frequently are they coming up, so we can convert sentences and even words into specific fields, specific functional areas. So that's the easy version of this for those of you like me that don't really write a ton of code. So what have we learned from this notion of natural language processing? Well, the first thing we can just see is what's the frequency of different terms that people write about when you bucket them into categories, and probably not that surprisingly, this notion of price or cost comes up a lot, right? It's an easy thing to talk about. People always want tickets to be cheaper than they are. Number two is team performance. Sort of hard for me personally to impact most of the time, but it is relevant for sure. Not only do we know the relative frequency of all these different areas, but we can drill into any individual one, and again, we can tie that notion back to the renewal rate associated with people that mention it to learn some pretty insightful things. I'll give you an example. One is this notion of ability to resell tickets. We talk a lot about resale. It just came from the ticketing analytics panel earlier, a lot of discussion of the impact of resale on our fans. And this is one that comes up a good amount, and in fact, it's one of the ones that has grown as a trending topic, right? It comes up increasing every single year as we've gone through the last couple years of our season ticket holder survey. So one, we know that this is more than ever top of mind for our season ticket members. And we can also tie the mention of resale to predicted renewal rates, and we see that this is one, when you see it, is a potential cause for concern. Because most people who mention this, regardless of exactly what they say, are expressing either concern about the value or difficulty dealing. We know who these people are, and we can tell them about options they have, either on the resale market through our internal channels or some of our charity programs where we can donate some tickets or opportunities to forward tickets to family and friends. So there are things we can do if we know this, and our ability to mine the free text through natural language processing gives us that flexibility. I'll contrast ability to resell tickets, kind of building a little full circle loop here, with team performance, right? Team performance is correlated positively with renewal rate, regardless of what people say. And as you can imagine, most people aren't going out of their way to tell us how much they appreciate a given team's performance. Usually they have some very specific thoughts and recommendations on how to remedy certain team situations, which of course we take into account. But you see this positive correlation. So just the fact that that's where people's heads are at, and they really want to dig into how the team is playing, means they're really a fan, right? They're invested in the team. So if we see this, again, it's not just that we see it, interpret it as a thumbs up and move on, but it is an important insight for us to know. And ideally, you know, we're using this information wherever possible to help bring our fans back year after year, right? That is the end goal here, to work with our teams and give them this information to not only know what they can expect, but to cater most specifically to any individual fan's needs, concerns, and wants, and to bring them from fence sitters to renewed season ticket members. And on the whole, we typically really do a nice job. We've got great staff and service at our teams, and this is something that we've been able to accomplish, and we're pretty proud of it. That being said, not everyone's going to renew. We're never going to renew 100% of seats. And every year, some people are going to decide that this isn't for them. That's okay, part of the ecosystem. But what we want to avoid is this notion of people leaving and then they're out, right? They're out of the ecosystem. Because a lot of these people are still great fans. And their future value to our teams could be very high. We need to continue to build a relationship with them and specifically, you know, understand why they left and how that teaches us something about their likelihood or potential likelihood to come back. So in addition to our season ticket member survey, we've done another survey, which is a non-renewed survey, where we ask people who were members in a previous year and not members this year, we say, hey, you know, we're sorry it didn't work out. Would love to hear from you. Again, people like to be heard, and a lot of people responded and gave us some really good information. And one thing we asked specifically is, you know, why'd you leave? Just tell us what were the reasons. And using these questions, we can cluster our non-renewed members into different buckets based on, you know, their primary motivation for not coming back. So we've got a bunch of different things, right? So we have life events, right? I got a new job, I moved, I got married, I had a kid. Circumstances have changed that, you know, 41 games just didn't fit into my life at this time. Got this notion of tip time. Either there's too many games or the start time. Maybe I work late and I can't get to the arena for a 7 o'clock start. We hear that a lot from people. Price, of course, right? Financial circumstances change. Prices go up, they go down. Maybe it doesn't fit within someone's discretionary budget. And then the fourth one is customer service, right? I don't like the people I'm interacting with at the team, either my season ticket representative or the game day staff, the ushers, the parking attendants, people that work the security line, et cetera, right? So we have four distinct groups like these, and then we ask them a question. We ask, you know, how likely, essentially, are you willing to consider buying a membership at some other point in the future? And the response to that question among these four different groups is really different, right? And it kind of makes sense, because if you said life event was my primary motivator, that's often a temporary thing, right? You just had a baby, it's just not going to happen. But, you know, down the road, when you have more free time, you're still a fan, you're still happy. Tip time and money, they're sort of in the middle. They're not insurmountable, people are still open to it, but they're more legitimate concerns that could be recurring concerns that are worth mentioning. The scarier one for us, as we learned, is this notion of customer service. And it's one of the reasons why, as a league, we've invested so much time and resources and done a partnership with the Disney Institute around this notion of how do we make sure our buildings are the best in sports from a customer service standpoint. Because this is the hardest one to come back from. People don't forget negative customer service experiences. This is not just an NBA or even a sports phenomenon. This is just a retailer service business phenomenon, right? It's really hard to dig out of this hole. And not only is it hard to dig out of the hole when you're already in it, we went back when we found this finding to, again, our season ticket member survey and looked at the times people had mentioned customer service as a complaint in some form in their survey and looked at how their likelihood to renew related to the average. It's 11% lower, 11%. I mean, a really meaningful downgrade for people that have this concern. So this makes us feel good about the time and resources we're investing in this area, because we know it's so important, not only in the renewal process year over year, but also in the long-term health of our business. And hopefully for those of you that have gone to an NBA game in any of our arenas in the last year, you appreciate the customer service and maybe have even noticed a step up in that area, because it's something that many of our buildings are focusing so strongly on. So I really appreciate all of your time today. I think there's so much great work that we are doing, and we're learning so much from our peers at the other leagues and teams, and really appreciate the opportunity to speak with you today. I would be remiss if I didn't mention that, you know, this is sort of the way our world is going, and we continue to grow our group and grow our resources. So for those of you that might be interested in working in the MBA, either in Teambo or at our teams going forward, you know, we have opportunities to do that, and we would love to hear from you, all for the benefit of, you know, turning our most loyal but sometimes least happy fans into our happiest fans, right? It all turned out well for Chris Depp's kid, so of course it has a happy ending. And with that, I really appreciate it. I would love questions if you guys have any. Sure. Yeah, it's a great point. The question was about multi-year sign-up. It's something that is very common in sports, in the suites world, in the premium world. Has become a little bit more common in the traditional ticket world. The Nets did it when they moved into their building. The Miami Heat have done some of it. It's something we're looking into. The data set with those is still pretty small. There's only a couple teams doing it, and obviously when you have specific team concerns, the Nets are going to be a really interesting case because they're moving into a brand new building, so it's sort of a one-off situation, and same for Miami. But that's a big one that we're very focused on seeing the relationship as we get a little bit more data on it. And the other one that is similar that more and more of our teams are doing, rather than signing up for a multi-year contract, it's this notion of auto-renew, right? So just like if you have a gym membership, you probably don't renew it every year, or your cable bill, you just kind of keep rolling through until you explicitly tell them to stop. This is something that more and more of our teams offer, and we think it's actually a pretty good benefit to our fans who want to be with us long-term. Obviously, it adds a stickiness factor, but it also just makes it easier for the majority of our fans who do renew their season tickets, you know, year after year. So, you know, that takes a little bit of the specific decision-making, year-on-year decision-making out of the process. So while it's a great tool, it also kind of obscures the data a little bit. So two things that we're definitely focused on. So, yeah, there. Thank you. Yeah, it's a great question, and actually one that I kind of glossed over, so I'm glad you asked it for the sake of time. But our retention modeling efforts in particular have become so much more sophisticated as we've had data. Initially, that notion of tenure, the rookie notion in particular, these first-year members, as you alluded to, it's just an adjustment if you've never had season tickets before. That's why we see that drop-off being most severe. So initially, we had it as one of the variables in our model, a special kind of binary for a rookie. But it's actually so powerful that we are now running parallel models, so a different model for rookies versus others, because the variables that drive renewal rate are substantially different. One example that we refer to is, you know, distance from the arena when you're a rookie is a very powerful notion, right? Because that you're new to this and you realize that I kind of live far away, it's kind of a pain to get here. That variable really disappears if you make it through the first year, right? Even if you live far away, you've done it for a year, you kind of know what to expect. Now it's not a driver anymore, but for first year folks, something like that can be powerful. And there are other similar findings as we go, and that's why we broke those out as a parallel model, both for our rookies. We also do a distinction for our, well, you know, true fans, and then for teams that have professional resellers, brokers. They have very different motivators than a true fan, as we might call them. So we model those differently as well. So, yeah, right there. Yeah, I mean, I think we see that, especially within the natural language processing world, as a potential next frontier. But two areas. One, you mentioned, you know, do we mine social media data? We haven't really done it yet, but it's absolutely something we're eager to explore. Another interesting notion that we kind of have discussed conceptually is, you know, we do a lot of outbound sales calling, right? We have large sales forces, so we'll call people, and we know when we make sales and when we don't, and sometimes we track like the common objections coming up. But conceptually, we love this idea of, you know, being able to get transcripts of calls, discussions with members, and apply NLP to that. So to say, you know, what are the things that even on the phone, in the heat of the moment, people are saying before they hang up the phone on us, and what can we do to adjust, and what are sort of the things that are triggers for people that are really nibbling on the hook and excited to buy, and ones that are kind of a lost cause. So I think it's a great thought. It's something that we would love to do with some more time and resources. I think at some point we might. So yeah, right in the middle. It's a great point, and it's actually something that we're spending a lot of time and a lot of our teams are really focused on. You know, the range of expense team by team allocated to the season ticket member, either benefit or staffing or outreach, is pretty wide, and trying to find what's the sweet spot, and then within that sweet spot, how do we allocate resources to any one event or cause or benefit is inextricably linked to this. So we've been able to use this to make stronger decisions about, you know, what's a better bang for the buck. The other thing that goes along with it, which is what our teams are starting to do, although, you know, there's some sensitivity around it in some cases, is really A/B testing our member benefits and outreach. So can we find true A/B tests where we can set up where we say, you know, we're gonna treat this member, we'll treat them all well, but slightly differently, right? Some people will get a phone call, some people will get an email, or some people will get $100 in arena cash, where some people will get $100 credit towards next season tickets, and see which of those, relative to their expense, and in some cases they might be the same, move the needle on retention outcomes. So this is something we're diving into a lot, for sure. So I think we got time maybe for one more. How about in the back? Yeah, it's a good question. The question was about how do, you know, the new ticketing technology, mobile, digital, and et cetera, how do they drive ticketing rates? I think it's a little tricky because often, at least in our league, there's a lot of interaction between the teams that try to pull it off, and sometimes teams in situations where they're more comfortable going to it because they think they can get away with it. So some of our stronger teams in some situations have been able to say, you know, this is a great opportunity for me to, you know, promote digital tickets because I have a full house and, you know, no one's really gonna turn away. So it's something we're focused on. I don't think we've seen really an extremely clear relationship one way or the other. We do believe it's where the world is going. So, you know, I think it's something that as more and more teams do, even more broadly, I think we'll be able to see if there are big fundamental shifts in the model as a whole as the industry moves more and more to paperless ticketing, digital ticketing, et cetera. We have time for one more, maybe? How about there, right there, yeah, in the white shirt. A great question. I think our typical response rate, and you guys can correct me if I'm wrong, is in like the 15 to 20% range. So it's not a absolutely huge sample size, and it definitely varies a lot by team. Some of our teams do a really great job with the outreach and getting higher response, and sometimes offering incentives to do so. I think we understand that the responding base as a whole is probably more engaged than your average fan, so there's some discounting to a lot of these variables that we do take into account. But I think we feel strongly that directionally, the findings and the relative weightings of the things that are important to individual fans is pretty meaningful. So, one more corner, yeah. Yeah, good question about sort of the relative differences between markets, especially ones with different makeups, right? We have transient markets, tourist markets, and some that are more locally focused. I think it's a kind of a great note to leave on because it's a great segue. Like this, I think a question like that underscores the importance of what we do in Teambo, but more specifically, what our teams do individually. The beauty of what we do is our ability to get enough data to make some comprehensive league insights like the ones we do here. So all of these findings are across the league and sort of smoothing away some of these differences. I don't doubt that there are specific, you know, market-specific observations that may move the needle. I think directionally we think these things hold for essentially all of our markets, but it's a really good question that underscores the importance we as a league have placed on, you know, internal data and analytics staffs that have the bandwidth and the data to dig into market-specific models. And, you know, not that long ago, you know, the average NBA team had one analytics person spread across everything. Now we're dealing with multiple people with multiple different areas of expertise diving into all areas of the business, including survey data, to make market-specific recommendations and to tell us, hey, you know, for the most part, we found pretty consistent things, but we've seen one or two differences based on our circumstance. And while maybe we can't build that in to the model globally, we definitely learned a lot from it. So I intentionally punted on the question a little bit. I recognize that. But, you know, I think that's the beauty of having the great ecosystem we have in the NBA analytics world of combining league-level insights with team-specific ones. So it's a good question. So I think that's it. I think we're out of time. So thanks a lot.